All right, the part of the chapter that I want to focus on in Romans chapter 1, we'll begin reading in verse number 18, where the Bible says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even His eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified Him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves." Verse 25, "Who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen." And I actually get the title of my sermon from verse number 25, where the Bible says they worshipped and served the creature. That's the title of the sermon. They worshipped and served the creature. Now, our culture has had an extreme change. You know, the nation of America has changed drastically. And especially in the past 5 to 10 years, but this change has begun over probably, you know, 40 or 50 years or so ago. And obviously, you know, there's no disagreement about the change. There's two different camps, there's two different sides as far as whether you would think that that's positive or whether you would think that that's negative. But you would have to be pretty much a Satanist or a communist to think that what's happened to our country is positive, and what's going on is positive, with 3,000 babies being murdered daily, with, you know, obviously you have all of our rights being taken away along with all of these things. You know, you just have sin in general with, you know, sodomy and homosexuals and perverts just running rampant, and they're everywhere. You know, but of course there's different tactics that Satan or the devil will use to try to get into nations that at one time were strongholds of Christianity. Now, I don't believe that our founding fathers, I've looked into, you know, the history of our founding fathers a lot, and I don't believe particularly that the founding fathers were Christians. I believe that they believed in the morals and the values of the Bible. Most of them were professing deists. They believed in God, and they would use the Bible as guidelines as far as the commandments and things like that. But so when I say that I believe our country was a Christian nation, I'm referring to the people of the country. Almost everyone was a devout Christian for years of throughout the history of our country. Almost everyone. So when Satan wants to come in and he wants to destroy a nation like that, he has to have, you know, different devised and calculated tactics that he uses. And one of those tactics that he used that we can see, you know, made a drastic change, a negative effect on our country, is evolution. The theory of evolution, the scientific theory of evolution. And what evolution teaches is that there's gradual changes throughout nature which have been taking place over millions of years. And that's our explanation of how we have everything today. That's our way that we can just write off God and, you know, and just say that we do not believe in God. Because that's all that it is. It's an excuse not to believe in God. But it goes further than that. The theory of evolution, the scientific theory of evolution, you know, is not only a scientific theory in and of itself. That's not where it ends. It's a philosophy that people have. And even within the scientific theory of evolution, even within the theory of evolution, they even teach you that today, they say that that human beings are basically at the top of the chain. They say that we are the furthest evolved. We're the farthest along evolved. And they believe that we're not physically evolving anymore, as far as naturally, like we're not going to grow another arm or anything like that. You know, what they teach actually is that we're socially and we're culturally evolving. And what this is also is, just like the theory of evolution, people accept that and they're receptive to that just so they don't have to believe in a creator. The you know, this other angle of evolution of teaching that, you know, that we're culturally evolving and that we're, you know, our culture is changing because we're getting greater and we're becoming better and we're understanding things, you know, in a different light and we're becoming more intelligent. All that is a way to explain away all the filth and all the disgusting things that have taken place. And it's their way of being able to implement something filthy and then saying, well, this is positive because we're evolving. And that's all that it is. And what we have today, and it's almost the masses of the United States, you know, They take polls of people that, you know, believe in Christianity, people that believe in evolution, but there's so many people that believe in a pseudo Christianity, and there's so many people that don't have that aren't saved. They're not a part of, you know, of what would be considered. Because I know I've seen some polls before where they'll go around and they'll ask people, like, would you consider yourself, like, born again? Or would you consider yourself a Christian? Would you consider yourself this? And then they would have, like, evolution in that category. And people, and this is normally, like Christian organizations that are pushing this. And they'll always say, you know, that the majority of the United States does not believe in evolution. And I would agree with that to an extent. I would say that's probably true. But when you start speaking to Christians, you start going around and you start asking them what their beliefs are on how the Bible actually turned out, there's always a varying degree of how much of evolution that they believe in. And whether or not they believe in the scientific theory, and this is what I'm going to preach about, they're always affected by the philosophy of evolution. They're always affected by the thinking and the way of life, because that's what it does. When you believe the Bible, when you believe, hey, God created the world, and God gave us commandments that we are supposed to live our lives by, we're commanded to abide our lives by, and you believe, you know, in the creation story, all those things affect your way of life and the way you look at life and the way you think. The same thing goes for the theory of evolution. These people, when they, you know, it's not just damaging people in the sense that it causes them to not believe in God. It also causes people, you know, to live their lives in a certain way, to have a certain philosophy and a way that they look at life. And people honestly believe that everything that's taking place in this world is always getting positive, and things are always getting better. Things are always getting better. Now, I'm going to show you from the Bible that this type of philosophy of worshiping the creature more than the creator isn't something new, where people exalt animals, where people exalt the earth, where people just, you know, worship nature and creation. This isn't something new. This is something that goes back thousands of years. This isn't a higher way of thinking, or because we're so much more intelligent today, you know, that's why we've evolved to this point of, you know, of living in our lives. Turn to Genesis chapter 1 and we'll start there. Genesis chapter 1 verse 20. This is a way that all the generations of the past have lived when they've rejected God's word and when they've rejected the Lord. It's always what they turn to. Genesis chapter 1, verse 20. So there's one of the major changes of our society, of the way that people think and the way that they live their lives, is the way that they look at animals. And specifically, the way that they look at animals in comparison to people. You know, many people today would admittingly, exalt animals in their own mind and tell you that, you know, that animals are on the same level or even greater than human beings today. Here, look at Genesis chapter 1 verse 20. We're going to see the distinction that God makes between animal life and human life, because the Bible is very clear about the value of a human and the value of an animal. Look at Genesis chapter 1 verse 20. The Bible says, "And God said, let the waters bring forth abundantly the moving creature that hath life, and fowl that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of heaven. And God created great whales and every living creature that moveth, which the waters brought forth abundantly after their kind, and every winged fowl after his kind. And God saw that it was good, and God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let fowl multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so." So notice one thing I want to point out before we continue reading is that over and over again it keeps saying he'll create a kind of animal that's entirely distinct to a different type of animal. And he'll say that they're going to bring forth after his kind. So they're reproducing the same type of animal continually. The Bible's really clear, and it completely contradicts the theory of evolution. There is no way that you can believe in evolution and you can also believe in the Bible. Sorry. Keep reading, though, where the Bible says right there, "And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. So notice the emphasis that he puts on the fact that man, that human beings were created in the image of God. We are created to look like God. It's clear that he's stressing that that's something important. And this is immediately following after he just created all the animals of the earth. So he creates all the animals of the earth, and then he creates man. And he's very clear that he created man in his own image. Right. And then he goes on and he emphasizes that. And he repeats it a couple of different times. Now another difference in the book of Genesis that we see in creation, when man's created, is that we see that man is given a soul. Animals are not created with a soul. And you know, the soul is what gives us the ability or the capability of existing forever. Now, whether that be in heaven or hell, when we die, our soul is what lives on. Animals, when they die, their body rots. You know, they have a life that is temporary, that is only on this earth. And when they're gone, their body is basically all that they have. They're dead and then they are gone. Now, look at Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, what the Bible says next. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. So when he gives a rundown of how he created all the animals, he then explains also how he created man, and then he gives a commandment to man. And the commandment that's given to man is that you're going to have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air. And then he's even clear, he says, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. So what he's saying is, you know, you are given, you know, the right or the permission to reign or to rule over all of my creation, over all of God's creation. Obviously not other human beings, but he's referring to the fact of all the animals that he created, everything that he listed off there. That man is given dominion. He's given power to rule and to use all the animals for our benefit. And this statement will offend a lot of people, but the whole purpose that animals are put upon this earth are for our benefit only and for our use only. Whether that be through harvesting them for food, or whether that be for riding them for transportation, or using them for whatever reason. The only reason why God created animals is to sustain us while we're on this earth. And right. For our benefit and for us to use the animals. Right. Now, there isn't a single mention of a person having a relationship with an animal in the entire Bible besides in a parable. And there's a lot of other weird things in a parable if you want to use that as a proof to, hey, you know, I don't think it's a sin to have a relationship with your animal, to love your animal or something like that. But this is a really big book and it's not mentioned one time in the entire book. There's a lot of people that live throughout the Bible. You know, a lot of people that are recorded that lived in the Bible. Many, many different lives that are recorded. Many great men of God. And if, number one, if God thought that was something important and something that we should have in our life, you know, that man needs a dog to be his best friend, then God would have recorded that in the Bible. God would have told us that, hey, this will help you through life. You know, but you know, the Bible's very, very clear that animals are put upon this earth for us to have dominion over. That's the only reason why God ever mentions of why animals are on this earth. For us to rule over them, for us to use them for our benefit and for our purpose. And a lot of people have this idea in their mind, you know, that God loves all of his creation. And they'll say, God loves the animals. But before you say things like that, and before you have preconceived ideas, you have to look at the Bible, and you need to have a Bible verse that says something, the reason why you believe what you believe. Right. Turn to Mark chapter 5, verse 5. And an example of that, one time I was having a conversation, or I was actually over Jessica, this was about 5 or 6 years ago, I was over Jessica's grandma's house. She was having a family gathering over there. She's a super sweet lady. She's like the epitome of the description of all, like, really sweet, humble, you know, grandmas. And Jessica had just like finished the last bit of milk, and she took the jug and she was throwing the jug away. And her grandma came over there and she was, you know, and she just told her, like, no, you gotta make sure you recycle everything. And she was, you know, talking about recycling. I don't think it's a sin, obviously, to recycle it. I don't think it's a bad thing to recycle. You know, we don't recycle, but she took the jug away from her and she put it in there and she was like, you gotta make sure that you recycle. And she was like lecturing Jesse, being real sweet and real nice about it, about making sure that you recycle things. And then she turned to me and she was as serious as can be, because she knew that I like read the Bible and stuff. And she's like, Tyler, that's got to be in the Bible somewhere, right? And she's like a professing Christian, but people get so ingrained. This is the point that I want to make in that story. People are so ingrained with the philosophies of this world and the philosophies that are derived from believing in the theory of evolution. And that's what this is. That's what all of this comes from. This eco-friendly, this, you know, ultra-heavy environmentalist attitude where people are just exalting animals and they're just obsessed with animals and they care more about animals than they do about people. This type of, all of this type of philosophy and attitude ultimately comes from, you know, the unbelieving world. And they're just constantly shoving it down your throat. And you may even believe this in an area of your life and you don't even realize it. Like I said, she's a professing Christian. She claims to be a Christian. And, she, as far as I can see, lives her life in a pretty moral way. You know, I don't know her real super well. But this can sink in. This can creep in into, excuse me. This can creep in to Christians' lives sometimes. The point that I want to get across. Now, look at Mark chapter 5. And this is the chapter, the famous little passage about the maniac of Gadara. And we'll begin reading in verse number 5. And the Bible says, "And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him and cried with a loud voice and said, 'What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not.' For he said unto me, 'Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit.' And he asked him, 'What is thy name?' And he answered, saying, 'My name is Legion, for we are many.' And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding." KK, go give me that water. "And all the devils besought him, saying, 'Send us into the swine, that we may enter into them.' And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down a steep place into a sea. They were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. Verse 14, "And they that fed the swine fled and told it in the city and in the country, and they went out to see what it was that was done." Now, however you want to look at this story and however you want to interpret this story, 2,000 pigs die. Either way you want to look at it. Now, and I'll tell you the way that one of the things that popped into my mind the very first time that I read this, and I think it almost every single time that I read the story, this wasn't Jesus' idea to do this. The devils were the one that were like, "Hey, send us into the swine." Jesus is not subject unto the devils. He could have chose whatever he wanted to do in this situation. He could have taken, you know, the devils and just cast them into the sea. He could have just taken the devils and just cast them out and not, you know, and not have possessed any other animals or any other beings or anything like that. Jesus could have chosen what he wanted to do. But he cared so little about these animals that he's just like, sure, just sends out the devils into the swine. And you know this, and you need to get, you know, think about this a little bit. That this is not 20 pigs. This is not one pig. This is 2,000 swine, 2,000 pigs that Jesus cared so little about that he just said, "Yeah, that's fine. Just sent the devils into the swine." And he knew what was going to happen. Obviously, Jesus Christ is God. He knew immediately when he sent the devils into the swine that all 2,000 of those pigs were going to die and drown. And not only die, they were going to die a very violent death. Now, if Jesus Christ were walking upon this earth today, number one, this contradicts what the majority of people would say. You know, that's what I believe Jesus is like. This is the type of person that I believe Jesus is like. You know, people have this idea today. You know, and even some, like I said, this can creep into even some real Christians who just never read their Bible. They have this idea that Jesus is like this hippie guru who's walking around and he's like hardcore animal friendly, like, you know, like a tree hugger. And they have this idea that his entire life that he just went around just like loving people constantly. And that's all that he did. And that is not how Jesus was. Jesus, number one, yeah, he had, in this story particularly, the reason why he did this, you know, was just because he had no care for the swine, and he had compassion upon the man. Because when you look down in the passage, he says in verse 19, "Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, 'Go home to thy friends, and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath had compassion on thee. So Jesus even says, you know, I had compassion on you. He was having compassion on that man. And if people were to have been there, like let's say that that were to happen modern day and Jesus Christ was walking on this earth and he sent 2,000, devils into the 2,000 swine and they ran, they died like a violent death. And people were like, man, that's this guy's fault. They would call the police and they would call PETA on Jesus. Seriously. If people saw that happen today, people would call the cops for sure on Jesus Christ. And these are a lot of these people are people that say, hey, I believe in Jesus. But they just have the wrong philosophy or the wrong view of how they look at God and how they look at the Bible and how they look at their life. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 5. In the context of this passage here is about pastors being paid. It's about men of God that are being paid. So look at 1 Corinthians chapter 9, and we'll begin reading in verse number 5. Paul says, have we not power to lead about a sister, a wife, as well as other apostles? And as the brethren of the Lord and Cephas, or I only and Barnabas, have not we power to forbear working? Who goeth to warfare any time at his own charges? Who planteth the vineyard and eateth not of the fruit thereof? Or who feedeth a flock and eateth not of the milk of the flock? Say I these things as a man, or saith not the law the same also? For it is written in the law of Moses, thou shalt not muzzle the mouth of the ox that treadeth out the corn. And then he asked the question, doth God take care for oxen? So what he's saying is, does God care about oxen? Does God care about cows? And then he says in verse 10, or saith he it altogether for our sake? So he's saying, or is the whole reason that that's written for us? Is the purpose for that verse being written in the Old Testament, because he's quoting the Old Testament, or is that written for our sakes? And then he answers the question, for our sakes, no doubt this is written. So there's no doubt. The whole purpose that was written, it says, is for us. That he that ploweth shall plow in hope, and that he that thresheth in hope should be partaker of his hope. So he asks the question, does God care about oxen? Does he care? Does he take care for oxen? And the question is no. And he says that he says it altogether for our sakes. That means that there's not a double meaning to this passage. There's a lot of things in the Bible that can have more than one interpretation. But the Bible says he said it altogether. The only reason that passage was written in the Old Testament was written for our sakes. The only reason why animals are here in the first place is for our sake. It's for our benefit. It's for our, for us to be able to use animals and to have gain from them. Whether that be, in an industrial sense, like I said before, whether that be harvesting them, eating them, whatever it's for. And the whole purpose why animals are upon this earth are for the sake of human beings. Now turn over, we'll look at another teaching of Jesus. Because like I said, that's somebody that a lot of people that fall into this, they tend to use Jesus Christ to support and lift up different ideas and views that they have. Look at Matthew chapter 6. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Matthew chapter 6, verse 25. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. And then he says again, another rhetorical question. Are ye not much better than they? So he asked the question, are ye not much better than they? And it's really, really clear. People can try to twist what he means right here, but the Bible is very, very, very clear about what he's trying to say. That human beings are much better. They're not equal unto. They are much greater than fowls. And God, we've seen here a few different examples where, number one, where somebody can say, well, yeah, God just doesn't care about the swine. God just doesn't care about them. They're scavengers. They're dirty, ugly animals. It's not like that's the type of animal that somebody takes into their house and cuddles and stuff like that. So people are fine to throw the pig under the bus. But so God, Jesus Christ threw 2,000 swine off. I understand that. God said that about the swine. God said that about, you know, oxen. God said that about birds. God is being very clear. God doesn't care about animals. God does not love animals. Now, it takes an incident like what took place in like the Cincinnati Zoo to really manifest how far the stupidity has come in this country and how far people will go to literally, now, and this is not an exaggeration, if there is a camp and a group today of people that literally would have been fine with letting that gorilla, if they would have been able to choose, to rip that child apart. They wouldn't have had any problem with it at all. They would have let it go as far as it would have gone. And I don't care what anybody's opinion is about whether or not that gorilla was gonna kill that kid or not, because that's complete idiocy. I've been to zoos constantly. We were like zoo buffs. We actually, and it's funny, we lived in greater Cincinnati area. So, and I live like 15, 20 minutes from the Cincinnati Zoo, and I've been there hundreds of times. Hundreds of times. And I've probably watched that exact gorilla walk around for tons of hours. We would go like 50 to like 75 times a year. Just constantly, like once a week we would go to the zoo. And I've watched gorilla carry around their young, and that's what people will try to say. You know, like he was trying to take care of that child. I have watched gorilla carry around their young all the time. And they always will put the baby on their back, or they'll hold the baby under their arm. They will never grab the baby by the heel and just take off running in a violent way, swinging the baby around. The child was like under the water drowning. And the only reason why that gorilla didn't kill that child earlier was because he was suspicious of what was going on. He wasn't, you know, he could kind of understand what was going on. When I watched the video, I watched the gorilla like three times, like look up at all the people like screaming and making havoc. And I saw one time after he had pulled the child over, where the kid was sitting at like a turned angle, kind of facing an opposite direction of him. And I watched the gorilla in the film as clear as day look up at the people and then look back down at the kid, grab the kid by the legs, and then turn him and make him face him. Because he wanted to make sure, like, I know what's going on. Like, they either want this child back. He had a sense of what was going on. And that was the only reason why he didn't kill the kid, I believe, right in the very beginning. And he ended up taking the child, I believe, if I remember correctly, and, like, carrying the child back up into the habitat. And I'm sure he was going somewhere in the exhibit to get to a secluded area to where he could kill the kid. You can say whatever you want for your own personal opinion, but every single animal behavioral, you know, specialist, every single animal expert that I've even heard on the radio, like these hardcore, like we're talking about animal lovers, all of them even said, like, yeah, the child was in immediate danger. The child was getting ready to die. But you have people who would have literally, who still argue and try to say, like, yeah, that, you know, they shouldn't have shot the gorilla. They shouldn't have killed the gorilla. And the only reason why they say that, to get down to it, the only reason they're arguing that the animal wasn't being violent in the first place is because they worship and they serve those creatures. Right. They really worship and serve. And people are like, well, you're going too far. They worship and they serve the creation. And the whole reason why they do that is because of their rejection of God and their rejection of God's word. They would rather set their affections on things on this earth. They would rather try to find something and dumb themselves down to a beast than rather serve God. And that's what it comes down to. They don't want God's word. And they will go to any extreme measures. They're so desperate not to serve the Creator and not to acknowledge that God created them and God, you know, exists, that they will literally serve and worship a gorilla. And this isn't something new, like I said. That's what I'm going to get more into here in just a second, is I'm going to show you passages all throughout the Old Testament where the heathen, those that are living in their own dung, and that's what people say today, is, we're so trendy and we're so new. You are living your life the same way that the pagans and the heathens who were worshiping idols and they were living in crap. That's how you live your life today. And they say, yeah, we're so intelligent, we're so new, you know, we're doing all these new things. No, it's all goes back to the rejection of God's word. And the same things took place in the past generation. You're not doing anything new. You're not, you know, you don't have this new, you know, found intelligence or this newfound, you know, we've developed, you know, evolved to a higher level. That's not what you're doing. You just hate God, and that's what's going on. Amen. Turn to Exodus chapter 32. There's nothing new under the sun. Exodus chapter 32. And we'll see even the children of Israel all those that, you know, the Bible says that they never believed, it says in Hebrews. Exodus chapter 32, we'll begin reading in just verse number 1. The Bible says, "And when the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mount, the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron, and said unto him, Up, make us gods which shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him." Wot just means no. "And Aaron said unto them, Break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, of your sons and of your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people break off the golden earrings which were in the ears, and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand, and fashioned it with a graving tool, after he had made it a molten calf. And they said, These be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And when Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation, and said, Tomorrow is a feast to the Lord." So here we see an example of somebody 3,000 years ago who are worshiping and serving the creature. They didn't just make an idol of just anything. They chose particularly, hey, we want to make an idol of a golden calf, of an animal. And that's not a coincidence that we see the same things going on today. And they do the exact same thing. Somebody could say, oh, well, they don't make idols. Like I said, I went to the zoo all the time. And when an animal dies, you know the first thing that they do, or the first project that they begin? They start making a graven image in the zoo. They want to have a graven image right by that exhibit where that animal used to be. And when you walk around the zoo, there are tons of idols and tons of graven images all over of every type of animal. Just constantly, all throughout the zoo. Turn to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. And also in the book of Exodus there, if we were to keep reading, we were to see the context of the passage and compare it over with the book of Corinthians. It talks about how they not only were making this graven image, but they started committing fornication. And that's what comes in. And you look at the extreme level that this goes to, like the extreme camp of these type of people, and they're all like super, super wicked. They are like the most pro-abortion. They're like the as liberal as you can be, like ultra communist. When you start looking at like these real hardcore liberals and the ones that are like super eco-friendly and they're just like really into the environment and all that, they're all very, very sinful people. And if they're not, a sodomite already, they're really pro-sodomite. And that's exactly what you see. And it's not a coincidence that you see that brought up in Romans chapter 1. And a lot of people, can have this, like I said, a little bit in their lives. But this isn't something that you, this type of philosophy that you want to have at all. Because if you knew the chapter that I derived my sermon from, Romans chapter 1, and you understood, how the people degrade there, and how it records the downward spiral, you don't want to be anywhere on that list. You don't even want to be at the very beginning just starting down that path. That's somewhere where you want to get as far away as you can. And we saw there, right smack dab in the middle, right before the person just becomes an extreme reprobate, that they worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator. So it's a result, and it's a philosophy that comes from just rejecting God's Word. They accept evolution in the first place because they don't want to believe in God. And then the philosophy just comes with the theory of evolution, with the scientific theory of evolution. That's the way that you're going to look at the world if you don't believe in God. So if someone, and like I said, there's a lot of people, and this is more of what I'm preaching on, that are Christians, that are maybe not even Christians, but that don't even know it, that believe this philosophy, that haven't bought into the theory of the scientific theory of evolution, but that still have been affected by this philosophy. Now, Acts chapter 7, where you're at, actually mentions this passage. It's going to move us in, I'm going to use it to segue into the next point, because there's another aspect of this, of worshiping and serving the creature. So Acts chapter 7, we'll begin reading in verse number 38. Verse number 38, it says, "This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel, which spake to him in the Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the lively oracles to give unto us, to whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again into Egypt, saying unto Aaron, Make us gods to go before us. For as for this Moses, which brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. And they made a calf in those days and offered sacrifice unto the idol and rejoiced in the works of their hand, of their own hands. Verse 42, then God turned, now watch this phrase, and gave them up to worship the host of heaven. Notice the exact same phrase that was mentioned over in Romans chapter 1. And what was the reason why? Because they worshiped and served the creature more than the creator. And we see the exact same thing mentioned here, where it says, and God gave them up to worship the host of heaven, as it is written in the book of the prophets, O ye house of Israel, have ye offered to me slain beasts and sacrifices by the space of 40 years in the wilderness? Yea, ye took up the tabernacle of Molech, and the star of your god Remphan, figures which ye made to worship them, and I will carry you away unto beyond Babylon. Turn to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 15. The other aspect that people can fall into this, or the other branch, is by worshiping the host of heaven. And the Bible uses that phrase repeatedly, and what it's always talking about is worshiping the sun, the moon, the stars, and the planets. And that's another thing that we see people constantly today. You know, and what inspired this sermon was I actually adapted like a 10-minute sermon that I preached in the preaching class months back, and I preached it the weekend of Earth Day. And I'll tell you that when I was a kid, I don't ever remember people talking about Earth Day. I looked it up and it was around at that time. But I don't remember people talking about it at all, like in school at all. And I asked a couple of people that were like maybe like 5 years younger than me, and they were like, yeah, man, we celebrated it. So you can see like where that line started to change massively. You can see, maybe it's different parts of the world. Maybe it's because I grew up in Kentucky that people don't, they care more about like killing animals and stuff like that, so they're not as conscious about like saving the Earth. But I don't remember people ever talking about Earth Day. And I hear it all the time out here, constantly. I even started to hear it in Kentucky even, you know, more and more as the years went on after I graduated. Now, you're in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 15. I'll read to you real quick from Amos chapter 5, verse 25 and verse 26. So it says, have ye offered unto me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Molech and Chion, your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves. Now you're in Deuteronomy chapter 4. Deuteronomy chapter 4. Look at verse 15. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 15, the Bible says, take ye therefore good heed unto yourselves. For ye saw no manner of similitude on the day that the Lord spake unto you in Horeb, out of the midst of the fire, lest ye corrupt yourselves and make you a graven image, the similitude of any figure, the likeness of male or female, the likeness of any beast that is on the earth, the likeness of any winged fowl that flieth in the air, the likeness of anything that creepeth on the ground, the likeness of any fish that is in the waters beneath the earth. So he warns them like really clearly, do not make an image or an idol of anything on this planet, of nothing that walks upon this planet. And that was basically what I covered in my first point, of how they worship, you know, the creature specifically. They pick out specific animals that people will worship and exalt and serve today. Now look at verse 19. And, so another point, lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven. And heaven in the Bible is just referring to like the sky, just like upwards. So, you know, the Bible actually records three heavens. You know, there's the heaven where God dwells. There's the heaven which was, you know, where the stars are at, where the sun is. And then there's the heaven where the fowl fly in. So he's just saying if you just look upward, basically is what he's saying. And lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun and the moon and the stars, even all the host of heaven, so there's that phrase, shouldest be driven to worship them and serve them, which the Lord thy God hath divided unto all nations under the whole heaven. Now turn to Deuteronomy chapter 17, and we're going to compare, you know, some of the wording and stuff with what we just saw. So this is a pretty serious warning, he said. He says in the very beginning, you know, take ye therefore good heed. He's saying beware, basically. Beware is what he's saying. He says take good heed. You need to be careful that you would start. And notice he puts into the same breath, he talks about the same type of people that would worship an animal, that would make an idol unto an animal, would also start worshiping the sun, the moon, the stars, the planets, maybe earth. He puts them both into one breath. Just like when he talked about in Acts chapter 7, we just looked at the children of Israel. They were doing the exact same thing. They were worshiping the animals. They were making a golden calf. And then they were also worshiping, looking up at the host of heaven and worshiping the host of the skies and other planets. And they said that they had a star of their God. So look at Deuteronomy chapter 17. Deuteronomy chapter 17, we'll look at verse 2. The Bible says, if there be found among you within any of thy gates which the Lord thy God giveth thee, man or woman that hath wrought wickedness in the sight of the Lord thy God in transgressing his covenant. Now watch this. And hath gone and served other gods. So notice, I want to point that out. Notice what it says. And hath gone and served other gods and worship them. Now watch what the gods are. Either the sun or moon or any of the host of heaven. So he says that this is your God. Either the sun or moon or any of the host of heaven, which I have not commanded. So you see that phrase again, any of the host of heaven. So he's just referring to all the planets. And so many people today would try to reject this, that I'm likening something, that they do today of what's different than the past. You know, the way that we make the idols of the animals and everything, you know, it's different than the way that they did it in the past. How? Well, I don't know. It's just different. It's just not the same. They wouldn't be able to explain to you how it's different. And people always want to do that. You know, the sins that we commit today, it's way different than the past. And this type of people, like I said, they're the ones that always tout this, we're so much more intelligent today than they were in the past. And they always want to talk about this specifically. We're so much more civilized than they were in the past. But they do the exact same things that the heathen did of the past. They do the exact same things that God warned people not to do. You know, this wasn't 20 years ago that this warning was given. This was thousands of years ago that this warning was given. And we see that coming to fruition. And what do they say? Well, we're not doing the same thing that they were doing. Of course not. This is entirely different. You know, we're not worshiping the planet, although we call it Mother Earth. But we're not worshiping the planet or anything like that. It's exactly the same. It's the exact same type of philosophy. It's the exact same type of attitude to where they lift up and they exalt the earth, they exalt the animals, and they worship and serve the creature more than the creator. Turn to, let's look at 2 Kings chapter 21 now. 2 Kings chapter 21. I'll read you from 2 Chronicles chapter 33. And this is, like I said, this is something that has happened throughout history in every generation. And it just comes from people that want to reject God and want to reject His Word. They have no other choice. They have to find something to serve, something to worship. So they choose to worship the creature. They choose to worship, the host of heaven, the stars, the earth, whatever it may be. 2 Chronicles chapter 33 verse 3 says, Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem, but did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, like unto the abominations of the heathen, whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. For he built again the high places which Hezekiah his father had broken down, and he reared up altars for Balaam, and made groves, and worshipped all the host of heaven, and served them. Also he built altars in the house of the Lord, whereof the Lord had said, in Jerusalem shall my name be forever. And he built altars for all the host of heaven in the two courts of the house of the Lord. And then watch this. And he caused his children to pass through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. Also he observed times, and he used enchantments, and he used witchcraft, and dealt with familiar spirit and with wizards. He wrought much evil in the sight of the Lord to provoke him to anger. And he set a carved image, the idol which he had made in the house of God, of which God had said to David and to Solomon, his son, in this house, and in Jerusalem, which I have chosen before all the tribes of Israel, will I put my name forever. Now you're at 2 Kings chapter 21. So I'm just going to show you some of these examples of this occurring over and over again throughout history. This is no new thing that people are doing today. 2 Kings chapter 21, look at verse number 1. Again about Manasseh. Manasseh was 12 years old when he began to reign, and reigned 50... Yeah, I had you turn to 2 Kings, right? Yeah, were you out? Okay. And reigned 55 years in Jerusalem, and his mother's name was Hephzibah. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord after the abomination of the heathen, whom the Lord cast out before the children of Israel. So it's another account of him. For he built up again the high places which Hezekiah his father had destroyed, and he reared up altars for Baal and made a grove, as did Ahab, king of Israel, and worshipped all the host of heaven and served them. Now turn to Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 5. Nehemiah chapter 9, verse 5. So over and over, and we can see, you know, the word Balaam keep coming up, like, which is Satan. We can see host of heaven, that they're worshiping all the host of heaven, all the stars and all the moon and the sun and the earth and all these other planets that they're worshiping. You keep seeing these same things coming up. And we can see that this is actually a sign of depravity. This is actually a sign of, you know, being a reprobate, like we saw in Romans chapter 1. Like we saw, Manasseh here, who was offering his son unto, you know, sacrificing his son to Balaam. We saw him offering his son to Baal. Then we saw him, you know, going unto, you know, to the wizards, and they're using enchantments and all this stuff. There's always a lot of other sin that's tied into this. So us as Christians, we need to stay as far away from it as we can. We need to make sure, like, hey, this is where the line's drawn with God. And we need to never cross this line. Here's the thing. If God doesn't take care for oxen, if God doesn't care about His creation, don't you think we should have the same attitude? I'm not saying go around and just like slaughter animals everywhere you go around. Use animals like He gave them to you, but I don't think that we should live our lives just like obsessing over animals and falling in love with all of our animals and, you know, wanting to be around all of our animals and not being able to just leave and go out of town or something like that because we're worried about our animals or our dogs. Obviously, also, we shouldn't just like, you know, put our animals in a room and just let them die or anything like that. You should take care of them in the sense of like, you know, making sure they have food and stuff like that. And I don't think it's wrong to have a pet. But we need to make sure that we draw the line, you know, where the Bible draws the line, and that we're not, you know, we're not just like obsessing, like I said. That's a good way to put it, because that's where a lot of people will fall into this category, where they're just like obsessed with their dogs, or they're just like obsessed with their animals, where they would literally rather spend time with animals than they would people. They would rather be around animals than they would be people. Then they would be people. Now, us as Christians, you know, the Bible's really clear. You're at Nehemiah chapter number 9. Whoops. Nehemiah chapter number 9, verse number 5. The Bible's really clear about the attitude that we should have towards, you know, God's creation. It says right here in verse number 5, "Then the Levites, Jeshua and Kadmiel and Bani and Hashabaniah, Sherebiah, Hodijah, Shebaniah, and Pethiah said, 'Stand up and bless the Lord your God forever and ever. And blessed be thy glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise.'" And then he says this, verse 6, "Though thou, even thou, art Lord alone, thou hast made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their hosts, the earth and all things that are therein, the seas and all that is therein, and thou preservest them all, and the host of heaven worshipeth thee." Now turn to Psalms chapter 148, and we'll end there. Psalms chapter 148. So we don't have to live our lives trying to preserve this planet or trying to preserve this earth. The Bible says right here in that verse, it says that God is the one that preserves this earth. And the one that we should be worshiping is the creator of all this. The one, you know, the one that was, you know, we should look at all of this creation, and that should drive us to worship God, just seeing how magnificent and how powerful that God is. Now we'll end in Psalms chapter 148. Yeah, I've done that twice now. Let me try to find this other verse. Psalms 148. I'll skip the other one. Psalms chapter 148. The Bible says, we'll just read this chapter here. Psalms chapter 148, the Bible says, "Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord from the heavens. Praise Him in the heights. Praise ye Him, all His angels. Praise ye Him, all His hosts. Praise ye Him, sun and moon. Praise Him, all ye stars of light. Praise Him, ye heavens of heavens, and ye waters that be above the heavens. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for He commanded, and they were created. He hath also established them forever and ever, and hath made a decree which shall not pass. Praise the Lord from the earth, ye dragons and all deeps, fire and hail, snow and vapor, stormy wind fulfilling His word, mountains and all hills, fruitful trees and all cedars, beasts and all cattle, creeping things and flying fowl, kings of the earth and all people, princes and all judges of the earth, both young men and maidens, old men and children, let them praise the name of the Lord, for His name alone is excellent. His glory is above the earth and heaven. He also exalteth the horn of His people, the praise of all His saints, even of the children of Israel, a people near unto Him. And then He says, praise ye the Lord. We should, instead of following the same pattern of the world, and following the same pattern of this New Age philosophy, which is a resurrected, you know, way of thinking of those of the past, the heathen of the past, the same people that have rejected God in the past, it's just the exact same thing of those that have, that are doing the same, that are rejecting God today. They're living their lives the same exact way, and they have the same exact way of thinking. But we, just as David did, just as all the Christians throughout history, should go to the Bible, and we should learn from the Bible what we should do. And right here, not only does it talk about praising God a lot, but it even mentions all these things that we saw people serving, we saw people worshiping. You know, because God's the creator of it all. If anybody deserves to be created or to be worshipped, you know, it's the Creator that deserves it, that honor and that praise. And that's who we should be giving the honor and the praise to. You know, He goes through and He says, you know, the sun needs to worship God. You know, the moon needs to worship God. All the animals and all the creation. And that goes for us too. We should, you know, spend our time, you know, not, you know, just looking at the creation and just saying, hey, man, that's magnificent. We should be saying, like, man, that's magnificent because God created it. Because He's a great God. Look at all this cool stuff that He was able to make. Instead of, you know, following the pattern of the world. So we need to not only, you know, make sure, you know, that we're not following for aspects of, like, you know, just the scientific theory of evolution, but we need to make sure that we're not affected by this philosophy, and that we understand how God feels about animals and how Jesus feels about animals, and how we should follow that exact same pattern in our lives with the way that we live our lives, the way that we look at this earth, the way that we view things, and we should make sure that we're giving the Creator all the worship and serving Him with everything that we have. Let's bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, we thank You for this opportunity to read from Your Word, dear Lord, and to learn from Your Word. We thank You for all the wisdom and how it sets forth the perfect philosophy, as I said, and the way that we should live our lives. And we ask You that you would just give us more wisdom and just help us to apply all these things to our lives. We love You, and we ask that You be with us. And in Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.